everyone. Thank you for coming early for this new year. I'm Kausal, I'm a blood surface maintainer, and I'm new to university. I'm a Red Hat engineer, I'm a current Red Hat, and I work out of India, and I will contribute to blood surface and Red Hat versus storage. So, today, I'll talk about Blastery and Blastery 2 mainly, but before that, I want to give a quick intro to BlastFS for anyone new to BlastFS. And finally, if time permits, I'll probably do a Blastery 2 demo of what it is right now.
So, is there a possibility to adjust the mic?
Okay.
Directory or a disk mounted to a path on your server,
which LustFS will expand as part of its volume. And the volume is a logical collection of bricks on which finally you store the data of the LustFS volume. And how you store it depends on the kind of volume you create. And a LustFS client is any process that directly talks to LustFS bricks using the LustFS LustFS protocol, network protocol. Yeah, and I already mentioned translators. Okay? So this is a general LustFS or a simple LustFS setup where you have servers on the bottom. These are all LustFS servers with LustFS installed. You got disks attached to them, those are bricks. And now we got a native fuse mount, native fuse client, which directly speaks to the servers. And then we got a lot of other services which also talk to LustFS via our GF API bindings. Let's see how we create a LustFS volume. It's really simple. If you want to actually go ahead and use it, you install LustFS server packages everywhere on the systems you want to actually, from which you want to create the LustFS volume. You do peer probes to set up your cluster storage pool. Peer probes are as in you just tell cluster that this is the set of servers that you want to be using. Once you have your cluster storage pool, you create the volume. It's a simple command line. You would have to actually have done mounting your actual disks wherever required, but yeah, this is a simple command to create the volume. You start the volume and you're ready to use it. So it's basically four steps that you can do it. I don't know why I have this, but it's a really bad diagram, but yeah. So a volume, as I said before, is a collection of bricks running on different servers. Our volumes, we define them as server or translator tabs. So we stack translators on both the client, server side and the client side. So we have a client side graph and we have a server side brick graph. So all our translators, create a graph out of them based on the volume create command you give. And then we stack processes, tables, basically, using these graphs. And those tables behave as the graph specifies. So on the client side, most of our logic is on the client side. The server side picks up basically dumb. They don't have a lot of logic there. All our distribution logic is in the distributed translator that happens on the client side. We have replicate, again happens on the client side. And you'll actually have a tree or a tree, not a simple graph like this, where from distribute you branch off to multiple branches, and from replicate you again branch off to get your features, to get replication, to get distribution. And similarly, if you have initial coding or Stripe or other Stripe, those translators also will be present in the server side graph, as on the client side graph. And the brick is just a simple linear graph right now, which has some features to help implement our processing state capabilities. Okay, so now, what is BlusterD then? BlusterD is the distributed management daemon for ClusterFS. This is what makes ClusterFS really easy to use, because it takes care of creating all those graphs, it takes care of starting all these processes everywhere, and makes it easy. Before ClusterD was present, ClusterFS user would have to write his own volume graphs called vol files, and you would have to distribute the files on your own, and you would have to start processes on your own. But ClusterD, you just have to write a simple command and ClusterD does everything for you. ClusterD runs on all the nodes of the cluster storage pool and helps manage the cluster storage pool. So it helps you to grow a string. So you can do peer probes to expand your cluster or cluster storage pool, and you can do peer detaches to shrink your cluster. ClusterD manages volumes. By manages volumes, I mean creates those graphs, so we have this volume graphs I talked about. It
it starts those processes, it does elastic or dynamic expansion and shrinkage of the surface volume, so you can do add rigs and remove rigs. And once you do expand or shrink, we need to rebalance data, so the surface manages the rebalance process, doesn't actually do the rebalance, but it manages all the payments that provide the surface features. It gives the clients the wall files. You don't have to copy a wall file from a server and put it on the client. So the surface client can just request custody for the wall file and it'll get the wall file and it'll mount. And it does a lot of other stuff, like managing a lot of other elements. Okay, so now we are replacing the custody. Basically, yeah, trying to redo cluster. And why you want to do it is because custody as it is right now is pretty bad. It's a big monolithic piece of code, unlike the rest of ClusterFS, where it has features in the small contained parts, which are translated as you stack and get features you can extend easily. And you can extend the file system part very easily. But ClusterD is a single monolith. And if you want to actually get any file system feature into the volume graph that we talked about, you have to mess with ClusterD to ensure that it generates graph with that particular translator. And doing that is pretty hard because it's really complex. I don't understand most of the code myself. So, yes, and someone coming in new will find it much tougher. And there are some problems with the architecture we have as well. ClusterD creates a mesh network between each ClusterD in the pool. So we got an n cross n squared connections in the network. And we have a concept of equal peers for ClusterD, that as in you should, we want to be able to do any of the cluster commands from any of the nodes in the pool. So we don't have a single linear there. So we try to do a lot of things to keep our store. Our store is what is our config database. We call a config database the store. It's basically back in ClusterD if you have to use ClusterD. And whatever is under that is our store. We try to keep this parallel ClusterD in sync across the cluster. And we do a lot of things to do that, which are complex and which lead to things like network floods in certain cases, and it makes ClusterD really hard to scale as we grow to a large number of nodes. And we want to fix this.
Is there a short question?
Yeah.
So what do you mean with large?
Large as in hundreds. So we do good in like tens of nodes. Once you go large, we have n squared connections and every operation we do kind of reaches out to all the nodes in the cluster because we want to keep our store in sync. Yeah. So, okay, let's start with ClusterD. What's ClusterD equal? Or ClusterD next? Because I got comments yesterday with, from a person saying that he was confused about what is ClusterD equal. It's like a new version of what? No, it's not. It's the second attempt to do it. I just call it 2.0, giving it sort of a version feel because it sounds nicer, that's it. It's going to be the next management table for ClusterFS 4.0 whenever it comes out. Yeah, it's the new implementation of GD where we attempt to solve all the problems we have, or at least try to. It's written in Go because it helps us concentrate more on our management problems rather than worrying about problems of C. It's being currently developed in a separate repository. Under the cluster organization, it will finally move into the core ClusterFS source. But it's still moving fast and changing a lot, so we have it in a separate repository. We are doing preview releases almost every month now. So we have the latest release where you can actually create volumes and mount from the ClusterFS clients, existing ClusterFS clients themselves. So that's good. So let's go on to what we are doing with ClusterD. So currently, we're trying to build out the core of ClusterD2. This is all the basic frameworks that we need to do our operations across the cluster. So we have things called transactions. Transactions are not in your sense of a database transaction or a transaction. This is a, what do you say? You would more likely call it an orchestration framework where we want to do operations across the cluster. We want to do a plugin-based architecture to keep clustering modular to help people actually implement features easily. And then we'll be implementing basic volume management and cluster management commands initially. So it's just basic creation of volumes, expansion, expansion to your cluster. Like about 5 basic commands initially. We want to come out with the initial release in like the next 3 months and just figure out this basic commands are going to help us figure out how we have to design all the core features. All the other features like managing a lot of we manage a lot of other services, we have hooks, we have blah blah blah, a lot of other things. So these things will come a little bit later. So now let's move on to what we have actually done. So I talked about the store, right? We had a distributed equal store earlier, where we did a lot of things to keep that one particular directory in sync everywhere. But right now, with GD2 or GD2, we are going to be using XCD, like everyone else is now, and move our store problem across to XCD. We could basically use
James, as I mentioned right now, has some thoughts about that, the way we do transactions. And so this is probably going to change before we do our final release. We have a payment manager in custody. The current custody, we manage payments. Okay, we manage like a lot of payments, and each payment is managed differently. Even though it's just starting a process with a one file, we have like each payment doing their own thing. So every new person who wants to start a payment comes into custody, writes their own code, and it's a mess. So if we want to change something there, it's really hard. So we have a common payment manager package that ideally it would be as simple as writing a service file and like you do with systemd, and that's when you just launch that service, launch the token, and it would just work. This payment manager also helps us communicate with the payments because we need to communicate with the payments to do certain actions. We want to do things like auto restart or have dependencies between the actual payments. These are things we are still working on and trying to figure out how to do it. With GD2, we have our management API is REST-based, HTTP-based, REST API. So in GD1, we use SunRPC-based API because REST-FS itself uses a SunRPC-based API. We just use that because it's available. But this is not really usable for all other external projects who want to actually talk to REST-FS and do their management actions. So we are doing a more universal HTTP-based API for all your management actions. So in the future, if you want to actually communicate with customers, do actions, you wouldn't need to run the cluster CLI to do. So if you could just directly talk to cluster API, the action is done. There is still a lot of stuff to do. We have to actually define the APIs all properly. We need to do formal specifications using one of these tools, Flutter or OpenAPI. We also need to figure out how we do so we also have gRPC in GD2. This is used for the communication between the study tools where we do our transactions, right? We talked about transactions. So to do that, we use GD2. gRPC, for people who don't know, it's an HTTP2 based RPC protocol that uses protobuf by default for encoding. It uses TLS by default, and that's good. We also will want to do plugins, and this is one of the possibilities we're going to use for communicating with plugins. We recently also implemented SunRPC. So this is a bit of a mess right now, but because we have three different RPC mechanisms in GD2, we finally want to reduce it to probably one, and that would probably be gRPC. But so we did implement SunRPC to just allow ourselves to do the volume start and allow clients to mount volumes right away. Because we tried to implement gRPC in the C code base, and that was much harder than doing SunRPC in the code. And we just did that. We have better logging in GD2. We generally helps us trace access across the cluster. So you'll be able to trace a particular operation throughout the cluster. It's a distributed operation, right? So without a proper logging, it would be really hard for us to track an operation across the cluster. Now, with structured logging, we add certain context to each log messages. So, things like in a transaction, would add a transaction ID to any log generated as a result of the transaction. So, you could track the progress of the transaction throughout the cluster. We still have to improve formatting a bit, but that's there. We still have a lot of stuff to do. Like I said, some of the stuff we have would be rewritten or redone again. We have stuff that is partially complete. We haven't done a lot of work on most of the things. We still need to write a lot of tests. We started out writing some unit tests and we did a bad job there, and so we are trying to not doing it. We need to restart it again and do it in a better way. And also we need to document everything that we do well. So let's talk about pluggability. I've been talking about pluggability a lot. But when I talk of pluggability, it's not just plugins that I'm talking about. It's a feature that I want to have with all the core frameworks of the city. So like we have our transaction frameworks that itself is pluggable, so that's extensible and it is flexible, so we can write transactions on your own orchestrations of your own order. You don't have to depend on a particular order that we specify like that.
Yes.
The aim is to allow external users to use those core frameworks without actually modifying the core frameworks and have these things well documented. So a lot of things require pluggability in ClusterFS. So yeah, translators need pluggability with us. When you have a new translator, you need to get it inserted into the volume graph. You need to understand or find out what options it has and to be able to set the translator options and other stuff. So we need to be able to add new commands, because when you when you get features, you get a related CLI command, or we need to be able to support that. So our CLI, the CLI should be pluggable to do this. As I mentioned, payment management should be pluggable, so it shouldn't be rigid. You should be able to easily start and stop payments as you wish. We want to do some sort of an event streaming framework where you get events from ClusterFS, ClusterD management events. This is required by some of the management UI projects, say like Over, to manage ClusterFS, right? So they would be really happy with things like events where they get say a bit going down, or you want to be created or something, reset and stuff. That would help them a lot. Now, we also have actual plugins. We are still discussing two approaches. With Go 1.8, we have a native dynamic plugin support that is we have to investigate. But we originally wanted to do a sub-process plugin model where our plugins themselves are like child processes of the cluster EDM and cluster EDM plugins communicate over gRPC to get stuff done. This is still in discussion. Yeah, WallZip is one of the core parts of Cluster. So generating our graphs is really important. Generating the correct graphs is also important. Doing this is slightly hard. In Cluster 1, we have this hard code as a series of a loop over table of translators that we have. So this table is hard coded in Cluster 1. And yeah, that's not flexible. To change it, it's really hard. So we are designing a new flexible version where we want to do something like we have system B service files. So each translator would provide a description file which says, okay, I have this translator, I need to be at this position in the graph. And a version package is going to figure out where the translator needs to be when it builds the graph. Using the volume information that you provide. So when you do create a volume, you say, okay, these are the things I want, these are the features I want. Lastly, the volume package will take this information plus the translator descriptions from the files and build your final graph instead of having it actually encoded in the study itself. So there's a POC in progress, I'm working on it. This is still not merged into actual study yet. We're also discussing events and hooks to allow things to happen dynamically. So, yeah, events are like a stream of events, which will help you like monitor the surface better. Hooks is we have hooks to actually right now say run certain shell scripts or scripts at particular points of execution of cluster E. You can do actions like say on a volume start, our script right now manages NFS Ganesha or Samba configuration, right? So the ClusterFS provides tools to actually automatically set up NFS Ganesha or Samba shares when you create start or stop volumes. So we use hooks to do that, so we need to provide that as well. There are some problems with the current hooks mechanisms where they are problematic. We have deadlocks and other stuff, so we have to solve them as well. Again, this is in the planning. That's it, I guess. So, in addition to that, as I mentioned, we still need to do a lot of documentation and testing, write a lot of tests to make sure we are actual. So, questions? I do have a demo, but I don't think I have time to do it. So. Any questions?
You're good about communication or observation?
So, right now we are using some RPC there, so we probably. The question was, what are we doing about authentication between cluster and custody two? That would be between clients and custody two. So right now, custody two doesn't actually do a lot of authentication. We have DLS-based authentication just to know that that Kyler is a client that we know, but otherwise we don't do anything about that. Again, for client communication, since we are right now using SunRPC to do this game, but we still have to talk about that. If we do switch to gRPC, gRPC has its own inbuilt authentication. You can plug in many authentication models into gRPC and we'll probably use that.
So considering you're switching to the CD, I assume this means that the number of modules
the question was, since we're switching to HCD, it would mean that the number of nodes we require, minimum number of nodes we require would increase. Yes. But we would still work in a single node fashion if you want to, or in a two node setup if you want to. But even with ClusterFS itself, now we recommend at least a three node setup so that you have sort of a coherent dollar split nodes. Like, if it is just a two node setup, you are going to probably have split nodes if something goes on. So, yeah, we'll still work in the single node or two node setups. We can do that. We do work in that. But it would be recommended either three or more. Yeah?
Can you say something about the release schedule for?
Okay, so as I mentioned, we are right now working on the core features for ClusterFS, the SOD. So we expect this to be done in the next 3 to 4 months. April, May, that thing. And we expect to complete everything to get feature parity with current ClusterFS before we actually do our ClusterFS about the release. So, yeah, we want to get the core ready so that we can start developing against ClusterFS 2 instead of like developing a specific one, all the new features that are coming. Okay, time's up. Thank you.